Section 25, because he is deemed to be a police officer for the purpose of Section 25 as well. So therefore, that confession is not admissible in evidence. Now, there are certain other officers belonging to other departments who exercise the powers of police officers. Some may exercise some of the powers, and some may exercise only powers of a police officer, including the power to file a final report under Section 173(2) before a competent magistrate or court. Now, there is a controversy now. The Honorable Supreme Court, at least on two occasions, in two different constitutional bench judgments, has held that the customs officers, the central excise officers, and like that, there are certain other officers are not at all police officers, though they are exercising some or many of the powers of police officers. Therefore, according to the Honorable Supreme Court, if any confession is made to any one of these officers, then the bar contained in Section 25 is not applicable because they are not either police officers or deemed to be police officers. Now, take the case of NARCA, the officers who are investigating the cases under the Narcotics Act, the narcotic NCB and other police and other officers. By appointment, they are not police officers, but they have been given lot of powers of police officers, including the power to arrest, power to search, power to enter, power to seize, and the power to file a private complaint. All these powers have been given. Now, in some of the judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court took the view, referring to and falling in line with the earlier judgments relating to Customs Act, the Honorable Supreme Court said that they are not police officers for the purpose of Section 25, and therefore any statement made to them, though it is a confession, is not hit by Section 25 of the Evidence Act. That is how, under the Narcotics Act, many confessions are nowadays admitted, which were actually made to these officers who are exercising their powers under the Narcotics Act. Now, the question has been raised before the Honorable Supreme Court. A division bench has raised a doubt as to whether these officers are police officers for the purpose of Section 25 of the Evidence Act or not. In Tofan Singh case, the matter has been referred to a larger bench, and the same is now pending consideration. The matter is being argued. So we are waiting for a judgment. Therefore, friends, whenever any confession made to an officer is sought to be placed before the court in order to find whether he is a police officer for the purpose of Section 25, apply these tests, these judgments. And what are the judgments, I will tell you at the end, I will circulate in the box, you can know it. I do not want to waste my time on this. So these are all confessions made to police, confessions made to deemed police, and confessions made to some of the officers who exercise only powers or most of the powers of the police officers. There are also confessions which are made to neither to a police officer nor to a magistrate. These confessions, as you all know very well, are all known as extrajudicial confessions. A confession made to a police officer itself is an extrajudicial confession, no doubt about that. But there is a subclassification. Confessions made to police officers or deemed police officers or officers who exercise the powers of the police officer, we can keep that in one category. The other confessions are confessions made to neither of these officers nor to a judicial magistrate. They are also falling within the category of extrajudicial confessions. Now, what is the evidentiary value of extrajudicial confession? You all know very well. Extrajudicial confession, as dealt with in Section 24, if it is found to be free from inducement, threat, or promise, is relevant, and the same is substantive evidence, which by itself is sufficient to convict an accused. But if there are doubts in respect of any such a confession as to whether there would have been some kind of threat, promise, or etc., or any other doubt in respect of the contents of the confession, then as a rule of prudence, the court has to look for corroboration from independent sources on material particulars. This is the law relating to extrajudicial confession. Now let us come to Section 26. Section 26 speaks of a confession made while in custody but in the presence of immediate presence of a magistrate. So these confessions which are made to judicial magistrates are called as judicial confessions. Now, judicial confessions can be the foundation, sole foundation for conviction, because there is guarantee that the confession was truly recorded, and after given sufficient warning to the to the accused. Now, how a judicial confession used to be recorded is dealt with in section 164 of the code. Now, I want to highlight two aspects in section 164 as to how a judicial confession used to be recorded so as to make it beyond any doubt. Now, section 164(2) states that the magistrate shall, before recording any such confession, explain to the person making it that he is not bound to make a confession. Number one, this is a communication made by the magistrate to the accused. What is the communication? He has to inform him. He has to make him to understand that he is not bound to make a confession. This is the first thing that he has to do. Not stopping with that, he has to convey yet another thing also. What is that? He should inform him that if he makes a confession, it may be used as evidence against him. So this is what we in common parlance call as warning by the magistrate. This is like one-way traffic. It is the duty of the magistrate to convey these two things. Look, you are not bound to make a confession. And if any such confession is made, it is likely to be used against you. It may be used against you. This warning the magistrate has to give. Why the lawmakers made such kind of provision here in section 164? It is because of Article 21 and Article 23 of the Constitution of India. Article 23 says that a person cannot be compelled to be a witness. That is testimonial compulsion. So if you want this provision or this right which emanates from the Constitution as a fundamental right, may not be known to the accused. Therefore, it is said in this provision that it is a duty of the magistrate to convey to him, to inform him about his constitutional right under Article 23, and also the right emanating from Article 21 of the Constitution of India. So this warning is in tune with Article 23 as well as Article 21, which speaks of a fair procedure. So this warning is to be given. After giving this warning, this is only convincingly telling him, persuading him, making him to understand. So after making him to so understand these warnings, what he has to do is that he has to give 24 hours time for him to rethink, to think it over, to relax himself. Then he has to come. If you look at section 164, you may not find a provision that after giving the warning, the accused is to be sent back to the prison and he has to be given 24 hours time to think it over. It is not found in section 164. But this is a development made by judicial pronouncements and the law declared by the Honorable Supreme Court in several judgments. Therefore, the law is that after making the first warning, he has to be given 24 hours time to think it over and to come in a relaxed mood on the next day with a decision whether to confess or not. This is the first part. Now the accused is produced again on the second day. On that day also, he has to again convey to him these two warnings. Number one, you are not bound to make a statement. Number two, if you make a statement, it may be used against you. This warning he has to again make. It is not sufficient to say that I made this warning already and therefore there is no need to make the warning once again. This warning should also be made, and there has to be a contemporaneous record prepared by the magistrate to show that this mandatory provision was complied with by him. This is very, very essential. Now, second day he is produced. This warning has been given. What he has to do? Then there is a duty cast upon the magistrate to make an assessment. It is an impartial assessment that he is required to make. What is that assessment? It is indicated in subsection 2 itself. This says, the magistrate shall not record any confession. The magistrate shall not record. There is a mandate. There is a direction to the magistrate. Don't record unless, upon questioning the person making it, he has reason to believe that it is being made voluntary. Therefore, here there is a mandate to the magistrate that he shall not record unless he is convinced, or unless he believes, the term used is belief, unless he has got reason to believe that the confession is going to be made voluntarily. Here there is an assessment made by the magistrate, and this should also be recorded by him in the confession itself. Now, after that, the accused is asked to confess. He confesses. Then after completing the confession, he has to read it over to him, and he has to accept, he has to sign. That is one part. Now, there is another direction to the magistrate, which is also mandatory, that he has to record a memorandum at the foot of such a record. What is that? That is also clearly stated here in subsection 4, which says, I have explained to so-and-so that he is not bound to make a confession. You see, he has already made that warning that he is recording here as a footnote. And that if he does so, any confession he may make may be used as evidence against him. So this is the first part, recording the warning that he has given. Now, second part, and I believe that this confession was voluntarily made. So he has to record his assessment of the mental condition of the accused as to whether he was voluntarily making the confession. As dealt with in subsection 2, if he has got any doubt about the voluntariness, then he shall not record. So he can record only after having satisfied his conscience that the confession is made voluntarily. So the second part that he has to record. Then after that, what he has to record is, it was taken in my presence and hearing, and was read over to the person making it and admitted by him to be correct, and it contains a full and true account of the statement made by him. So if suppose this footnote is found missing in a particular case, what is the legal effect? I will tell you only one case for your consideration. That is Chandran versus State, reported in 1978 Supreme Court. In that case, the London magistrate, instead of recording that he believed that this confession was voluntarily made, he said that I hope that this confession was made voluntarily. This was raised as an issue before the Honorable Supreme Court. Before the Supreme Court, the argument was, because the magistrate had no belief or no satisfaction that the confession was made voluntarily, he has used a different language. The Honorable Supreme Court went into the literal meaning of these two words, that is hope and belief, and finally held that because the magistrate had some doubt about the voluntariness, he had used a different language. Therefore, this confession is not voluntarily, and as a consequence, it is not admissible under Section 24 of the Evidence Act. The confession was rejected by the Honorable Supreme Court on this. All right. So I had occasion to deal with another case where the learned magistrate, after recording the confession, simply recorded in the footnote like this. It was taken in my presence, hearing, read over, he admitted and signed. He has not recorded the first part, namely the warning that he gave and his satisfaction about the voluntariness of the confession. Whether this is only a defect which is curable or which goes to the root of the case is to be decided based on the facts and circumstances of each case. But one thing is very clear, this part can be in fact cured. If you go to section 463 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, it provides for curing such a defects in the confession. 463 may read section 463. If any court before which a confession or other statement of an accused person recorded or purporting to be recorded under section 164 or section 281 is tendered or has been received in evidence finds that any of the provisions of either of such sections have not been complied with by the magistrate recording the statement, it may, notwithstanding anything contained in section 91 of the Evidence Act, take evidence in regard to such non-compliance. So the magistrate of the trial court is empowered to call the magistrate to the court to take evidence, to call for explanation from him by way of evidence as to why this mandatory requirement was not complied with. The trial court has got immense power to do that. Very good. Let me read further. And may, after having called the magistrate to the court as a witness, after having afforded an opportunity to him to explain as to why he did not comply with these mandatory provisions, the trial court has to now make an assessment. What is it? If satisfied that such a non-compliance has not injured the accused in his defense on the merits and that he duly made the statement recorded, admit such statement. Earlier I said, if the statement, the footnote is not found, it creates a doubt as to whether it is voluntary or not. If there is such a doubt, then it is not admissible under section 24 of the Evidence Act. Now, this section says that it can be admitted. Despite that such a non-compliance, the court can admit the same in evidence. When? If the court is satisfied that such a non-compliance has not injured the accused in his defense. So there is no more explanation here as to how to test whether this has injured the defense of the accused or not. Now my understanding of this provision would be that unless there are contemporaneous records in the confession itself, for example, I say, before further explaining, the accused is produced, the magistrate is, after warning, the magistrate has to assess. What is the assessment? That the confession is going to be made voluntarily. How such assessment can be made? What are the inputs with the magistrate? There is nothing before him. So therefore, he has to gather the inputs. That is also indicated in section 164 itself. 164 says that upon questioning the accused, therefore, it is for the magistrate to put any question to him in order to ascertain, in order to gather materials, in order to find reasons as to whether the confession is going to be made voluntarily or not. In a given case, suppose the magistrate has recorded the questions and the answers elicited, but he has failed to record the footnote alone, and he explains to the court that it was out of inadvertence. I failed to record the footnote, but I have recorded in the confession as to what are all the questions put by me and what are all the answers given by him. I have recorded, I was satisfied. Then this explanation of the magistrate is acceptable in my view. It is acceptable, and such an event, this non-complaint will not render the confession inadmissible. This is, but in the case which I told you, that is Chandran's case, the magistrate was not called by the prosecution, neither by the court, to explain as to why he used a different language. Instead of using belief, I believe, why did he use I hope? There was no explanation offered. He was not summoned. So therefore, the Honorable Supreme Court found no other way, no option except to reject the confession. In the case which I dealt with also, there was no such explanation of obtained from the magistrate. Therefore, the confession had to be rejected as inadmissible. It is one thing to say that the confession is admissible, and because of certain doubts, no reliance can be made on that. That is regarding probative value. Now, I am talking on the issue of very admissibility itself. Unless the confession is free from these three evils, namely coercion, threat, or promise, it is not admissible at all. I am on the question of very admissibility, not on the probative value. Please mind that. Therefore, this is the way in which a judicial confession is recorded. Now, the Honorable Supreme Court has been taking consistent view that since in the judicial confession, there are certain guarantees. What is the first guarantee? The accused has been given sufficient warning. That is in compliance with Article 23 of the Constitution. He has been warned. Despite the warning, he gives confession. Therefore, it is presumed that it is voluntary. And apart from that, the magistrate himself, upon questioning the accused, and from the answers elicited from him, has assessed his mental condition, and has recorded that he gave the confession voluntarily. Therefore, there is a guarantee to some extent that the confession was made voluntarily. After all these safeguards, since such a confession is recorded by a judicial authority who has got no interest in the case, then the Honorable Supreme Court says that this confession can be the sole foundation for convicting the accused. There need not be any other evidence at all. It is one thing to say that there are evidences. Despite this, if there are some doubts regarding the confession, then as a rule of prudence, the court may look for some corroboration from other evidences in material particulars. That is on the question of appreciation of evidence. Therefore, my friends, in these three categories of confessions, so far as confession made to a police officer, an officer who is deemed to be a police officer, there is a complete bar under Section 25, therefore it is not admissible. So far as the officers who are exercising some of the powers of police officers and other third parties who are not officers, the confession which is extrajudicial can be admitted, provided it is made clear to the court that there was no threat, promise, or coercion. This is the second category of confession. The third category of confession is the confession made to a judicial magistrate. That is a judicial confession. In all the three, what is to be ensured by the court is that there was no threat, there was no coercion, or there was no promise. In such an event only, the confession is admissible in evidence. I do not want to take much of your time on this further. Now let me pass on to directly to Section 27. Now next comes Section 27. Section 27 is a proviso to Section 25 of the Evidence Act. Section 25 says that confession made to a police officer at any point of time is not admissible in evidence. Section 27 is a proviso. Now, before going to Section 27, I want to highlight one more aspect for your consideration. If you look at Section 25, it says in two lines, no confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of any offense. It says that a confession made to a police officer cannot be used against him. No confession made to a police officer shall be proved as against a person accused of any offense. It cannot be used against him. It cannot be admitted as evidence against him. Therefore, what is the reverse? It can be used in his favor. So if a confession has been made by an accused, it is nothing but a previous statement, but it can be used in his favor. So that is the inference we could draw from Section 25, from the language of Section 25. Now, let us take a case where during the course of investigation, the accused is arrested and he makes a confession. In that confession, he says that he exercises the right of private defense, or he says about provocation, etc. He says some defenses are available in that. The question is, can he use the confession in his favor? Yes, certainly, if you look at Section 25, the confession made cannot be used against him, but it can be made use of in his favor if it will reduce the offense from a major offense to minor offense, or if it will help the court to reduce the sentence because his family circumstances, everything are stated therein, it can certainly be used in his favor, as there is no prohibition under Section 25 to use in his favor. So it may be the first impression, but hurdle for the accused comes by way of Section 162. If you look at Section 162, it says that no statement made during the course of investigation shall be used for any purpose. There is a general bar. Whether such a statement is made by the accused or a witness, it is immaterial. If any statement is made during the course of investigation to the police officer, to the investigating officer, then such a statement cannot be used for any purpose at all. But the proviso to Section 162 carves out certain exceptions. Even Section 162 also permits the statement to be used only for one purpose. That is for the purpose of contradicting the maker, provided the maker, namely the person who made the statement, is examined as a prosecution witness in the same case. If the person who made the statement is examined as a defense witness or as a court witness, the statement cannot be used to contradict. And further, the statement cannot be used for the purpose of general cross-examination. 162 CRPC permits the statement to be used only for one single purpose. That is for the purpose of contradicting the maker. Suppose the accused wants to use the statement, wants to use the confession in his favor. As I already told you, Section 25 is not a bar, but Section 162 is a bar. Therefore, if the confession had been made to a police officer during the course of investigation, falling under Section 161 of the code, then it cannot be used for any purpose, including for the purpose of using it in favor of the accused. So that is how the confession of the accused becomes useless, either in his favor or against him, except the proviso contained in Section 27. Now, let us take another illustration. Suppose after committing the crime, the accused goes to the police station and he makes a confession to the police officer. Based on that confession, FIR is registered. Now, this confession, which forms part of the, which is the first and earliest information upon which the case has been registered, is not a statement falling under Section 161, so as to attract the bar under Section 162 of the code. This statement is much prior to the commencement of the investigation. You all know very well that investigation commences after the registration of the case. Here, this confession was made before registration of the case, and upon this confession only case itself is registered. Therefore, this will not fall under Section 161 of the code, and therefore it will not be barred by Section 162. this confession cannot be used against him because this is the bar under section 25 will operate. I have already told you that to attract section 25, it is not necessary that the confession should have been made to an officer investigating the case. To any officer, any police officer, any time, anywhere, that is barred by section 25, which cannot be used against him. But if this confession made upon which FIR was registered is in favor of the accused, then he can certainly use the same in his favor. He can admit the confession. He can very well say that this was the confession made by me. It is admissible because I want to use it in my favor. Section 25 is not a bar. So 25 is not a bar to use the same in my favor. 162 is not applicable because this was not made during the investigation. Such a confession can be made use of by the accused. Please, my dear friends, you may have an occasion where in a case, you may not find any valid defense from out of the answers elicited during cross-examination of prosecution witnesses or from any other material. At the end, you may have to rely on, fall back on the confession of the accused itself. But the confession can be used in favor of the accused only in one circumstance, which I've already told you, that is, which was made prior to the registration of the case. And after the registration of the case, if any confession is made, it is not admissible at all. Okay. So this is a confession made to the police. Suppose the accused from the jail writes a letter to the magistrate, to the police officer investigating the case, wherein he confesses whether this would be hit by section 25. Yes, certainly it will be hit. Because this will be hit both under section 25 as well as by section 162 of the Code of Criminal Procedure. 25 of the Evidence Act says confession made to the police officer. 162 says that any statement made during the course of investigation. So both the bars will apply, therefore that is not admissible. Suppose the accused writes a letter to the jail superintendent and he records it. He makes a statement, he records it. What is the evidentiary value of that? Is it a confession made to a police officer? Now we have to examine whether the person who acts as the jail superintendent is a police officer. There are also instances where the officers who are from the police department are drawn to the jail department and they are asked to manage the jails. So by appointment, he is a police officer. If by appointment, he is a police officer, confession made to him in the jail is also hit by section 25. If on the contrary, he is an officer appointed, not as a police officer, not from the police department, but in the jail department, he is not a police officer. He is nothing but a superintendent or manager managing the jail. He has got nothing to do with either detection of crime or prevention of crime. So as to be a police officer, such a confession is admissible in evidence. This is all about confession. Very often, and I can say that almost in all cases, we find that there is a confession. Now this has become a trend for the police officers to produce a statement said to have been given by the accused as confession before the court for some purpose or the other. Now, as I just now told you, that section 27 is a proviso to section 25. Section 27 says that so much of information which leads to the discovery of a fact alone is admissible in evidence. Now, there is a long confession given by the accused. There is a long confession given by the accused. In that he says about his family, background, etc., etc., and the way in which he committed the crime and where he has hidden some article, like a theft article, etc. He gives such a long statement. Now, what happened? Before 1947, there were divergent views expressed by various courts. Referring to section 27, please kindly look into section 127 for a moment. provided that, that is why I said that this is a proviso. This is a proviso of Section 25. Provided that when any fact is deposed as discovered in consequence of the information received. Please kindly underline this word. It is not in consequence of confession. In consequence of an information received from a person accused of any offense in the custody of the police officer. So one more condition is that Section 25 does not say that at the time when he makes the statement, he should have been in police custody. But Section 27 says that at the time when he makes the statement, he should be in the police custody, that is after arrest. Now there was a lot of controversies over this. Some court said that custody can be had only by arrest, and therefore any confession made after such arrest, after the person has come into custody alone, will fall under Section 27. Now this has been watered down by the Honorable Supreme Court in very many judgments. Law is so settled, which says that the moment he goes and surrenders to the police, or the moment the police officer keeps him under his control, then it is deemed that he is under in custody, in the custody of the police officer. Therefore, for the purpose of Section 27, it need not necessarily be an arrest, which is a lawful arrest under custody. If he surrenders or if he submits himself to the custody of the police, then, or if the police officer keeps him under his control, then there is a deemed custody for the purpose of Section 27. And so the information, so much of information is admissible under Section 27. Please kindly see the further. So much of such information, whether it amounts to a confession or not, as relates distinctly to the fact thereby discovered, may be proved. Here you have to take note of one more phrase. Whether it amounts to a confession or not. Earlier, I wanted you to note one thing, that is, in consequence of information, I pointed out it is not in consequence of confession. Now, again, it is repeated here, whether it means the information amounts to confession or not. Therefore, Section 27 speaks only of an information, not anything more. That information, according to this phrase, may be a confession or may not be a confession even. The information need not be a confession. It may be, it is only an information. At times it may be a confession. At times it may not be a confession also. Now, referring to this provision, on interpreting this, there were divergent views expressed by various high courts. More particularly, a full bunch of Madras High Court in Athappa County case took the view that if once there is discovery of a fact, so in a common parlance we call it, for our understanding I am saying, recovery of a material object. This for understanding I am saying, but strictly speaking, as per Section 27, discovery of a fact. So something is recovered from out of the information given by the accused. Then the Madras High Court took the view that the entire confession, commencing from the first word to last word, is admissible. So this was in 1937 Madras. So this was the law holding the field in the Madras, so far as the Madras state is concerned. What was happening was, based on such a confession made to the police officer, people were all convicted, holding that the confession is voluntary, it is admissible, and that is how the people were all convicted. This was going on for about 10 years. Then came the judgment of the Honorable Privy Council in 1947, Pulikuri Kottaya. In Pulikuri Kottaya's case, the Privy Council reversed the view taken by the Madras High Court. Now, in Pulikuri Kottaya's case, you may kindly keep in mind, these are the words. He gave a long confession in which lastly he said, if you take me, I will show you the place where I have hidden the knife with which I stabbed Sivayya. This was the statement. Now, as per review of the Madras High Court, not only this line, the entire confession was admissible. But in Pulikuri Kottaya, the Privy Council took the view that reject the entire confession, which have got no relevance which have got nothing to do with the discovery of a fact at all. So this one line in the confession alone relates to a discovery. What is that one line? If you take me, I will show you the place where I have hidden the knife, okay, with which I stabbed Shivayya. The Privy Council said, referring to this word as relates distinctly. The term distinctly was taken note of very seriously by the Privy Council, and the Privy Council said that segregate and find out those words which are very essential to form an information for the purpose of discovery of fact. Admit that portion alone, not the entire confession, not any other portion. So saying, in this case, in the illustration, in Pulikuru Kata's case, the Privy Council said that if you take me to so-and-so place, I will identify, I will show the knife which I have hidden. This part alone is admissible. With which I stabbed Sivayya was held to be inadmissible. But practically saying that in many courts, without understanding this legal consequence, the some portions which have got nothing to do with this distinctly are also admitted. So my dear friends, be careful while dealing with any such confession under Section 27 to see whether it falls within the norms prescribed or laid down by the Privy Council in Pulikuri Kottaya, which has been accepted by Indian courts, by the Honorable Supreme Court in number of judgments. These are all very elementary. Therefore, I do not want to say anything more. My point here in Section 27 is, I told you when we read Section 27, 25, we have to see that confession can be used in his favor, because bar is only to the against him. Now come to Section 27, it says, the confession, whether it amounts to a confession or not. In the Pulikuri Kottaya case, I will show you the place where I have hidden the knife. There is no confession. It is nothing but a simple information. There is no confession because the confession part has been deleted from admission. But there are cases where the information may amount to confession. In Pulikuri Kottaya's case, the information is not a confession at all. It is only an information. In any case, for that matter, you can say, in most of the cases which we do every day, the accused will make a voluntary confession statement in which he will say that I have hidden the properties in so-and-so place. I have hidden the stolen properties in so-and-so place. This stolen, the term stolen is inadmissible. I have hidden the gold chain in so-and-so place. That alone is admissible, not the stolen, the history. These things are not at all admissible in evidence. Okay, so this is what Section 27 says. Now, one more thing in Section 27 is that the information may amount to confession. That phrase is also there. I give you one small illustration by which you can understand. Now, suppose the accused gives a confession like this: I have hidden 100 grams of ganja in my house. Now you can, if you take out this ganja from the statement, then it makes no sense at all. Therefore, the entire statement, that this entire line is to be admitted. What is that? I will show you, I have hidden 100 grams of ganja in my house. So here, this statement amounts to confession. Please understand, when you read any legal, any provision of any statute, you have to find meaning for every word and what the legislature is intended to convey. That if you, with that in mind, if you look at this, you will find why this phrase has been used by Mr. Stephen, the author of the Evidence Act, whether it amounts to a confession or not. So this is, you read this Pulikuri Kottaya for the purpose of Section 27, and for the that has been approved or being followed in several judgments of this honorable by the Honorable Supreme Court, So I do not want to take much time on that. Now let us go to Section 30 of the Evidence Act. Section 30 of the Evidence Act speaks of the confession of a co-accused. The confession of co-accused is not relevant at all. It is no evidence at all. There is some popular misconception in certain sections of the legal fraternity even that a confession of the co-accused can be used against the other accused. How, under what circumstance can be used is to be deliberated upon. If you look at Section 30, it says that when more persons than one are being jointly tried jointly for the same offense, and a confession made by one such person affecting himself and some other such person is proved, the court may take into consideration. Section 30 does not declare that it is irrelevant. It only says that it can be only taken into consideration. Now, in a given case, suppose the first accused gives a confession. Let it be a judicial confession. Let it be an extrajudicial confession made to some other officer or somebody. Can this be used against the co-accused, against A2? That is dealt with in Section 30 of the Evidence Act. The first and foremost condition for this is, for employing Section 30, is that there has to be a joint trial first of all. If there is no joint trial, then confession made by the other accused cannot even be admitted in evidence. It is totally inadmissible. Very good. Let us say that there is a joint trial. Then how the confession is to be made use of? No. Whether it can be the substantive evidence? No, it cannot be. This question arose before the before the Privy Council in Bhubani Sagu versus the King, AIR 1949 Privy Council, page 257. AIR 1949 Privy Council, page 257. There, the Privy Council held as to how an extrajudicial a confession of a co-accused is to be approached by the court. The Privy Council said that first, to begin with, keep the confession of the co-accused aside first. Don't look into that at all. Don't look at. Keep it aside. Marshal all the other evidences available in the case against him. You look into the other evidences. Marshal them. Assess them. On such marshalling, on such assessment of all the other evidences, if the court comes to the conclusion, yes, this A2 is guilty, then as a last resort, look into the confession made by the first accused, namely the co-accused. A question arose before the Privy Council. When the court has already come to the conclusion from all the other evidences that he is guilty, then why should the court look into the co-accused confession? The Privy Council answered and said that it is with a view to further strengthen your conclusion which you already arrived at. Therefore, in nutshell, you cannot begin with the confession of the co-accused, and if there is no other evidence at all against the accused, the confession of the co-accused will have no use and it cannot be considered at all for any purpose. This was the law laid down by the Privy Council in Bhubani Sagu, AIR 1949. This judgment was subsequently followed by the Honorable Supreme Court in Kashmira Singh versus State of Madhya Pradesh, in reported in AIR 1952 Supreme Court, page 159, Kashmira Singh. Now, this Kashmira Singh was somehow or the other doubted. Therefore, the matter went before a constitution bench to decide this small issue as to how to deal with the confession of the co-accused. That was in Haricharan Gurmi versus State of Bihar, reported in AIR 1964 Supreme Court, page 1184. Page 1184. So as per this judgment, where in this judgment, the Constitution Bench upheld the view taken in the earlier two judgments, one by the Privy Council, which was followed in Kashmir Singh by the Supreme Court. Therefore, the law as on today is that the confession of the co-accused is of no use. And the proper approach, what is the little use? It is not completely no use. There is a little use. What is the little use? You have to first marshal all the other evidences, keeping the confession of the co-accused aside. And on such marshalling, on such assessment, if the court is able to come to the conclusion that he is guilty, then as a last resort, in order to add strength to the said conclusion, the court can also look into the confession of the confession of the co-accused. So this is the very little use which the confession of the co-accused can be made use of. This is the settled law. Now, there has arisen some problem with this law also of late. Now, apart from the magistrate, now under certain special enactments, even a police officer has been empowered to record a confession by giving warning, by satisfying himself about the voluntariness, etc. Take for example, the Third Act, Terrorism Act. In that act, section 15 of the act says two things. Number one, confession need not be recorded judicially by a magistrate. A police officer, often above the rank of superintendent of police, is empowered to record a confession. And he is required to make the same warnings and the same procedure which are followed under section 164 by a magistrate. Such a confession is admissible in evidence, though he is a police officer. Please mind that. I was telling the general law, as per section 25, that a confession made to a police officer is totally inadmissible, except as per the proviso to section 27. But there are certain enactments, more particularly in the Third Act, there is a provision which says that a confession made to this police officer, namely an officer of and above the rank of superintendent of police, is admissible in evidence. Because this is a special enactment, this excludes and overrides section 25. Such a confession is admissible. This provision further says that such a confession is substantive evidence against the co-accused as well. Therefore, section 30 to some extent is also excluded under the Third Act. The only condition is that there has to be a joint trial. That has not been done away with. If there is joint trial, the confession made to a police officer by the first accused is admissible and it is substantive against the first accused, and again it is substantive against the second accused as well, because the section 30 is not made applicable to that extent. This provision was challenged on the ground that it is unreasonable, it is arbitrary. You please kindly see, if a confession is made by an approver, then the approver is in the box. His evidence can be tested by means of cross-examination. The truth or otherwise of the confession, the statement, evidence can be tested by means of cross-examination. But in this case, he is a co-accused. He is not going to be examined. Assuming that the first accused examines himself as a witness, as a defense witness, after taking permission under section 315 of the code, the second accused cannot cross-examine him effectively. And citing this as a reason, and also on various other grounds, it was argued before the Honorable Supreme Court in Kartar Singh versus State of Punjab reported in 1994 3 SEC page 569, where this provision was challenged. The Honorable Supreme Court in this case declared that it is constitutional and it is not ultra vires of Article 14 as well as Article 21 of the Constitution of India. Therefore, a trend has now come to be in stay, that special enactments are made now where such a provision is made to overcome the bar in Section 25 as well as in Section 30. There are some special enactments. Those special enactments could not be challenged on the touchstone of constitutionality because of the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Kartar Singh. So therefore, virtually, in many special enactments, the solemn function of Section 25 and 30 have been done away with. In my personal view, that this judgment, if not in the near future, one day this may be reconsidered by the Honorable Supreme Court by a larger bench and it will undergo some change. So this is regarding Section 30. Now, again, reverting back to Section 27, Section 27, as I pointed out to you, mandates that the confession or the information should have been made while in custody. I also told you that custody can be heard by arrest. The moment a person is arrested, he comes to the custody of the police. And I also told you, even in the absence of arrest, a person can surrender himself to the authority of the police, to the custody. Thereby, he can come to the custody of the police, I said. Now, this provision classifies a person in custody and a person not in custody. Let us say that in a particular case, there are two accused. One accused makes a confession while in custody, which leads to a discovery of a fact. This statement is admissible against him under Section 27. Suppose the second accused, without coming to the custody of the police, makes a statement. He is not in the custody of the police. Then his statement is not falling under Section 27. This was argued as an unreasonable classification, and it was argued as an arbitrary classification. They said, when you are giving the benefit to a person who has not been arrested, why the same benefit is not given to me? The police officer refuses to arrest one accused. Record the statement. Section 27 is not applicable. In other case, the police officer exercises his power and arrests him. There the statement becomes admissible under Section 27. So this was argued as unreasonable classification. The Honorable Supreme Court, this is a very interesting case. I would request all our friends to once read the judgment. This has traced the entire history of confession. This has traced the purpose of Section 27 as to how Section 27 is reasonable. Section 27, there the Honorable Supreme Court, while upholding the constitutionality of Section 27, rejecting this argument of arbitrariness, etc., held like this. Even though the confession or statement made while in custody is tainted and so inadmissible, if the truth of the information is assured by the discovery, it may be presumed to be true, and therefore it is admissible. So there is a presumption that it is untainted, otherwise it is true. Therefore, it is admissible. With this observation, by majority, there are 5 judges. 3 judges said Section 27 is constitutionally valid. One judge, a very celebrated judge of yesteryears, Honorable Justice Subbarao, he said that this Section 27, not only Section 27, Section 162, which permits a statement admissible as stated in proviso of section 162. He says, both the provisions are unconstitutional. This was the view taken by Honorable Justice Subbarao. Now, the fifth judge, Honorable Justice Hidayatullah, he concurred with the majority, but he gave his own reasons. Therefore, ultimately, the order of the court was by 4-1. Four judges holding that Section 27 is constitutionally valid, this classification is reasonable, and there is no arbitrariness. One judge holding that it is, this classification is unreasonable, it is arbitrary, and therefore Section 27 is unconstitutional. There are now, brothers, there are two line of thinking. Please kindly see whether it is constitutional or unconstitutional. Though we are bound by the judgment, our thinking process cannot stop, nothing can deter us from having this thinking process further, and one day to again test the same. The judgment, all I would request all our friends to read the judgment once. AIR 1960 Supreme Court, page 1125. 1125. Please kindly read the judgment. And subsequently, the very same judgment, very same provision, section 27, came to be challenged in another case before the Honorable Supreme Court. This time, this is after the advent of the Constitution, this judgment again came. In the judgment, it was tested on the ground that it is hit by Article 23. It amounts to testimonial compulsion. Therefore, Section 27 should be struck down as unconstitutional. This view was, this was taken in State of Bombay versus Kadigal Agad. This is a very popular case, you know very well. In Kadigal Agad case, Section 27 was challenged on a different ground. There they said that it is hit by Article 23. Here again, the Constitution bench held, no, it is not hit by that. So therefore, there are at least two Constitution bench judgments now upholding Section 27 of the Evidence Act. Now, one more thing I want to say. With this, I will go to Section 10. In Navjot Singh Chandu's case, that is Parliament attack case, all these provisions came up for consideration before the Honorable Supreme Court. Honorable Justice P.V. Reddy, yet another eminent judge of yesteryears, and has held, discussed about one important issue. There is a popular view that if a joint confession is made by two people simultaneously or jointly, which leads to the discovery of a fact, then unless it is shown as to whose information is the first information, the confession, it cannot be admitted. Similarly, if two people take the police officer together and point out the place where the incriminating article is hidden, the earlier view was such joint discovery is also not admissible in evidence under Section 27. Now, this was reconsidered in Chandu's case. Now, be friend, be informed that the law today is that joint confession, simultaneous confession, simultaneous information, simultaneous joint information leading to joint recovery is not a bar to admit the confession or the statement under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. The Honorable Supreme Court in Navjot Singh Chandu's case, this is a vast departure made after several decades, to my knowledge. The judgment now, the Chandu's case 2014, you know very well. These are the observations made by the Honorable Supreme Court. Section 27 speaks of a person accused of. This word has been interpreted. Now it says a person accused need not be a single person. It could be two or more persons. Simultaneous disclosure is not does not make it the statement inadmissible. Simultaneous The language used is joint disclosure, simultaneous disclosure. Per se does not make the statement inadmissible. This is the law holding the field as on today. My dear friends, please keep this in mind. Now let us go to Section 10 of the Evidence Act. Hitherto I was saying that a confession made by a co-accused is of no use, virtually no use, except the limited purpose for which it can be used. While referring to Section 30, I was repeatedly saying, I also told you about the Tada Act, etc. Now, if you go to Section 10 of the Evidence Act, this is very interesting. Now, I will take another 10 minutes, I will close. Please kindly come to Section 10. This says, where there is a reasonable ground to believe that two or more persons have conspired together to commit an offense. So first of all, there has to be a reasonable ground to believe that two or more persons have conspired. This is the initial condition which is to be satisfied. Yeah, if this is satisfied, what follows? Section says, or an action put on, anything said, done, or written by any one of such persons in reference to their common intention after the time when such intention was first entertained by any one of them is a relevant fact as against each of the persons believed to be so conspiring. So this is very easy to understand. The first and foremost condition is that the court should have reasons, grounds to believe that there was conspiracy between these accused. Let it be 2, 3, 4, any number of accused. If the court arrives at such a conclusion, then anything said, that is any statement made, anything done, anything said, anything done, or anything written, all the three, during the period of conspiracy is substantive evidence against all to prove only one thing, that is conspiracy. Please understand this. Section 10 in the opening part states that the court should have reasonable ground to believe that there is conspiracy. Then it says, if you once hold, or not wholly, if you once hold such a view that there was conspiracy, then anything said, anything written, anything done is a substantive evidence against all the accused. If I give a small illustration, then you will understand this. Suppose three people conspire on January 1st to commit the murder of one X, three persons now. Now, murder takes place on 10th January. So, January 1st, conspiracy takes place. January 10th, murder takes place. In between, on one day, one accused makes a confession to his friend. See, all three of us have decided to do away with this man. This is a confession made by one accused in the absence of the other two accused. This is made on January 2nd. So January 3rd, the second accused writes a letter to his friend where he says, we have decided to do away with that man, but we want money. Please keep money arranged. I will come and collect it. This letter written by second accused is collected and produced before the court. This is also nothing but a statement by one of the accused in the absence of the other two. Now, third accused on 5th January, he goes to a shop and purchases a knife in the absence of the accused one and two. That knife was subsequently used for the purpose of commission of the crime. Now, he did something. So one accused made a statement orally. The other one made a written statement. The other one did a thing. He purchased. all these three can be used as substantive evidence against the respective person. No difficulty in that. If I write a letter, I am bound by that. I am responsible. I got to explain. If I do a particular thing, you can make use of that against me because I am bound by that. But this is used against the others. Section 10 permits that. Section 10 permits that. You please kindly see. To you employ Section 10, two, three conditions are required. Number one, the confession, first of all, from out of the other materials, including this, from out of the other materials, the court should found grounds, should find grounds, that is reasonable grounds, to believe that there was conspiracy. This from the rest of the evidences, the court has to come to a prima facie conclusion. Yes, there was conspiracy. If this conclusion, not conclusion, this belief is arrived at, if this belief is arrived at, then the court can invoke Section 10. By invoking Section 10, now the confession, the statement, the something done, everything can be brought on record by admission as substantive evidence. Based on that, the accused can be, or each accused can be convicted based on this. The statement made by the other accused. So Section 10 is in a way like a proviso to Section 24 as well as Section 30 and also Section 27. But question arose as to whether any statement made after the main offense has been committed is admissible under Section 10. No, the Honorable Supreme Court in very many number of cases, including in that Navjot Singh Chandu's case, has reiterated that if a confession or any statement or anything done after the conspired act is done is not admissible. Suppose the accused is arrested after the main occurrence. He makes a judicial confession or he makes an extrajudicial confession, anything. That is admissible only against him. It is governed by Section 30 as against others. It will not fall under Section 10. Please kindly note that in order to employ Section 10, the statement, either oral or written or anything done, should have come into being when the conspiracy was still in force, still yet to be executed. If once the conspired act is executed, then the conspiracy comes to an end. Therefore, after that, whatever is said, whatever is written, whatever is done, is not admissible by employing Section 10 of the Evidence Act. If you see in most of the cases where the conspiracy is hatched in secrecy, in most of the cases, it is difficult to prove the conspiracy by means of direct evidence. By means of circumstantial evidence, it can be proved. Suppose the circumstantial evidence is also wanting on certain aspects. If the circumstantial evidence do not make out a complete chain, then that missing link can be supplied by these statements admitted under Section 10 of the Evidence Act. This provision, Section 10, was employed at least in four cases to convict the accused. Though there was no sufficient evidence to convict the accused, supplying the missing links, filling up the gaps by the use of the evidence admitted under Section 10, hardcore criminals were all convicted in this country. So Section 10 is an enabling provision to prove only conspiracy. But please also be informed of that section, anything admitted under section 10 will be relevant to prove only the conspiracy, not the main offense, not the other offenses committed. That limitation also you should not forget. Section 10 is only for the purpose of proving the conspiracy, because the conspiracy by itself is an offense now as per section 120B of IPC. To punish a person under section 120B, not for punishing him for any other offense like 302 or any other offense, only for the purpose of punishing a person for the offense of conspiracy, you can employ section 10. That is a limitation contained in section 10. Now, if you want to know the true import or the sweep of this particular provision, section 10, which is often used in very sensational cases, please kindly read at least 4 or 5 judgments. Number one, the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of assassination of our Honorable then Prime Minister, Madam Indira Gandhi. Then the next one is the assassination case of the former Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. Then this parliament attack case, Navjot Singh Chandu. Then that Bombay blast case. These are all the cases. If you read the last one, the Navjot Singh Sandhu's case, a classic judgment by Honorable Justice P.V. Reddy on section 10, referring to all the previous judgments on this. And I do not want to read all those judgments, and I do not want to trace even the history of section 10. As I believe that this much is enough for me to say on this aspect. So, in conclusion, I would say, I'm sorry, before conclusion, I told you that I would cite some judgments to you. We kindly take note of the judgment in Agnu Nagesia versus State of Bihar. Agnu Nagesia versus State of Bihar, 1965 Supreme Court AIR, wherein the Honorable Supreme Court has dealt with the issue as to whether the confession made by the accused can be used in his favor. At what stage? So there was one case, Muttai Thevan case, from Privy from Madras High Court, where the Madras High Court took the view that the confession can be made use of in his favor. That was distinguished subsequently by the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court has now said that in that case, on facts, the confession was made before the FIR was registered. It was only on the basis of the confession FIR itself was registered. Therefore, section 25 is not a bar to use the statement in his favor. But 162 bar is not applicable because it was made before registration of the case. For that purpose, you please kindly read this judgment, Agnu Nagesia versus State of Bihar. Now, so far as the officer, police officer, and all the other things, this Tofan Singh versus State of Tamil Nadu, that is pending before the Honorable Supreme Court on reference. Now, judgment is yet to come. The reference is as to whether the officers of NCB, Narcotic Control Bureau, are police officers for the purpose of Section 25. Admittedly, they are not police officers appointed in terms of the Police Act. They are officers drawn from various other departments. Whether they are police officers only for the purpose of Section 25, so as to admit or not to admit the confession made by the accused under Section 67 of the Act. That is pending before the Honorable Supreme Court. We are waiting for a judgment. The matter is being argued before the Honorable Supreme Court. So therefore, in conclusion, I would say that Section 24 speaks of a confession which is admissible if it is free from threat, promise, or coercion. 25 is a complete bar if it is made to a police officer. Then who is a police officer is a question to be answered in each case. Then section 27, constitutionality has been upheld, though there are divergent views on that. Now Section 27 says that any information which leads distinctly to the discovery of fact alone is admissible. Now, coming to Section 30, condition for accepting the coaccused confession is that there has to be a joint trial. Number two, the proper approach is to keep it aside, marshal or assess all the other evidences, and if only the court is able to come to the conclusion that the accused is guilty, then in order to reassure itself, the court can look into the coaccused confession also. That the limited purpose for which it can be used. I have also told you that nowadays a trend has set in this country that special laws are made to overcome Section 25, Section 27, as well as Section 30 by making provisions stating that confession made to a police officer is also admissible in certain circumstances on satisfying certain conditions, and that is also substantive evidence against the co-accused also. Some Section 30 is also overcome by these special provisions. Such law has been upheld by the Honorable Supreme Court in Kartar Singh. So this is the latest trend that also I have pointed out to you. Then so far as Section 10 is concerned, I have explained to you that Section 10 can be applied only in case, in the event the court finds grounds to believe, reasonable grounds to believe that there was conspiracy, then these statements are admissible against everyone. There Section 30 is not applicable. As I told you, Section 30 plays a vital role, makes the confession of the co-accused of very little use. But Section 10 says that the confession of the co-accused, if it was made during the period of conspiracy, is fully admissible. It is substantive against the co-accused also, but it will go only to prove the conspiracy, not to prove any other offense. That is what Section 10 also I have said. Then regarding Section 27, I have already pointed out to you that there is a swift change in the law. What was the law before Chandu was that joint discovery, joint disclosure, simultaneous disclosure, simultaneous discovery were all held to be inadmissible in those days. Now the law has been changed in Chandu's case. Therefore, joint discovery is also admissible. And I think that with this, the time is up. Therefore, I can conclude. Thank you, Mr. Vikrant, for having given me this wonderful opportunity. Now, over to you. If there is any question, I am prepared to answer. Please.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you. Though you have given such an insights.
Yes.
For good 1 hour, 40 minutes.
Yes.
Large issues which were in the mind of the participants, they would be over. But still, there are certain questions. Priyanka Yadav, whether a co-prisoner.
Yes. Yes.
The participants need not write thank you, because in that entire game, question gets popped up. Whether a co-prisoner can be a person in authority, if he said accused that better to confess, otherwise police torture you bitterly. I have also faced this torture. Whether or not this will be hit by Section 24 if accused makes such confession.
Certainly it is hit by Section 24, because for the purpose of applying the bar under Section 24, I told you that Section 24 is negative. It speaks of irrelevancy, not about relevancy. So it says that if it appears to the court that the confession would have been obtained by either coercion, undue influence, etc., then the confession is irrelevant. How it will appear, it cannot be defined. In case to case, we have to see whether there appears some material to show that the confession was obtained by promise, threat, etc. Here in the illustration, in the issue which you have placed before me, I am 100% sure that this confession is hit by Section 24. It is not admissible. It is irrelevant, because there are sufficient materials on record to infer that it was obtained by means of this promise, coercion, etc. Okay. Yes.
Statement made by accused during investigation of the case.
Yes. Please.
During the investigation of the case in the office of the IO, who is a special officer like the office of CIFO, will he be deemed as a statement under custody? The said accused was not arrested by CIFO.
Yes. See, two things. Now, Section 24 does not require that the officer should be an officer in charge of the case or an officer in charge of police station or an officer investigating the case. He may be any police officer. So here, it is immaterial whether he was this officer or that officer. He is a police officer by appointment. Therefore, Section 25 completely bars the statement from being admitted. Okay. Number two. So for the purpose of 27, for the purpose of 27, the person must be in custody. That was the argument before the Constitution bench. So Supreme Court, the classification, whether in custody or not in custody, there is arbitrary classification that has been negative. Now, when a person will come into custody, there are a number of judgments where one judgment of the Madras High Court in Roshan BV, full bench judgment, authored by Honorable Justice Ratnamal Pandian, was later on upheld by him. This is reported in Kartar Singh also, where they have said that custody does not mean a custody secured by means of arrest. A custody can be made by mere surrender. By mere surrender. You know about that Joginder Kumar's case also. The accused surrenders, gets into the custody, therefore entitled for bail. For surrendering an accused to the court, there is no provision. Where is the provision? Therefore, custody, if you go to that, the another case authored by Honorable Justice Ratnamal Pandian, Anupam Gulkarni, 1994, the same issue, when a person comes into custody, a person can come into custody on arrest or on his own surrender or the officer keeping him under his control. Anupam Gulkarni case. This has been very categorically held by Honorable Justice Ratnamal Pandian. Therefore, in this case, undoubtedly he is in the custody of the police. Therefore, the statement made by him is inadmissible as per Section 25. And if at all any recovery is made, to that extent, that statement is admissible under Section 27 of the Evidence Act. Yes.
Right, sir. Sunil Kumar Bangri, how can it be proved that the confession of the accused was made / taken simultaneously?
Simultaneously. That is very easy. The police have seen many confession recorded like this. The confession made by so-and-so, two people. Story is same. The police officer will say, these two people said, and it is not like a bhajan singing together. So he said, and this man also said, and both were interchangeably saying, I recorded that. He said one word, he said the second word, he said the third word like that. I have seen confessions recorded like this by the police officer. So joint confession made by so-and-so. I have seen that. So that is the reason why the Supreme Court was all along saying that unless it is found as to who made the first statement, then we cannot apply Section 27. Now in Chandu's case, a departure has been made. That's a problem now. Yes.
Priyanshu Yadav, explain the scope of term in reference to the proceedings as mentioned in Section 24.
In reference to?
Section 24.
No, Section 24 not in reference to. Section 10 alone speaks of that.
I can unmute Priyanshu because he has two, three questions.
Having reference to the charge against the accused. Having reference, not in reference. Having reference to the charge against the accused. Okay, what is going to be the charge ultimately? In reference to that, he to a made statement. That is, relating to that, he to a made statement. That is confession. Suppose an accused speaks about his involvement in some other crime. That confession is not admissible in the present case. It may be relevant in the other case. So a confession made in respect of the offense which is being tried, that alone is admissible. That is what in reference to is conveys.
Okay. Palvi, in the statement of confession, example given that I have at my home 10 grams of ganja, this will be inadmissible? Which part will be considered relevant?
That is what I said. See, this is a very interesting question that one friend has asked. if you look at section 27, this phrase, so much of such information. What is the information? I have hidden ganja in my house. This is the information. Whether it amounts to a confession or not. So here it is a confession. It is admissible. So we may have some doubt. Because earlier, the section says information received. So it is, there is a scope to argue that the information means not a confession. In order to obviate that kind of argument, this has been again clarified in the very same section to say whether it amounts to a confession or not. Therefore, if the accused says, I have hidden 100 grams of gold in my house, there is no confession. This is only an information. The same accused, if he says, I have hidden 100 grams of ganja in my house, then possession of ganja amounts to confession. He is possessing ganja in his house. It is confession. So it amounts to confession. Though it amounts to confession, it is admissible under section 27. Because if you remove that word, in Pulikuri Kotaya, one phrase was removed. I have hidden the knife at my house with which I stabbed Sivaya. So with which I stabbed Sivaya can be deleted, removed from consideration, from admission. So the argument before the Privy Council in Pulikuri Kotaya was, if this is removed, then which knife? With which I stabbed Sivaya supplies that link. This was the argument. Supreme Court said no. I'm sorry, Privy Council said, and Supreme Court has also approved. That link is to be established by means of other evidence, not by this. Okay. Now, I also want to tell our friend that for the purpose of Section 25, it is not every information or it is not every fact discovered make the statement admissible. It is inferable that the discovered fact should have relevance to the crime concerned. If that link is missing, then the statement is not admissible. Let me say one small illustration. Suppose there is a theft in the house. Jewels are stolen. Now, some jewels have been recovered from the accused. He says that I have hidden the jewels at my house. There is no confession in this. I have hidden the jewels in my house. There is no confession. It's only an information. Now, if there is no evidence to say that these property, these ornaments recovered from the accused are stolen properties, if that evidence is wanting, then the statement itself becomes inadmissible because the relevance of the discovered fact has not been established by the prosecution. In many cases, I have seen the prosecutor omitting to ask this question. How this link is to be established? First of all, it is to be established that the accused made this statement. Number two, it should be established that from out of the statement, the jewel was recovered, that was discovered. So section 27. Now, one more thing. Thirdly, it should also be established by showing the jewel to its owner and say that this was the jewel which was stolen from a house. If this part of the evidence is not available, then section 27 will not be applicable. Therefore, to put it in nutshell, in one line, I will say, it is not every discovery which makes the statement admissible. It is only discovery of a relevant fact which makes the statement admissible. The relevancy is to be established by means of other evidence. Yes, brother?
Selvam, the phrase person accused is descriptive. FIR registered subsequently after confession had been made to police officer.
Yes.
Where do we get that the phrase person accused of is descriptive? So this is that posted at 6:45 on the chat box.
No. See, what is the question? See, confession is made before the FIR is registered.
The phrase person accused of is descriptive. FIR registered subsequently after confession had been made to police officer.
Where do
we get that the phrase person accused of is descriptive?
No. See, that for that you have to go to section 25. Say section 25 bar is there. Whether the statement was made, you just see section 25 does not have any qualification. It does not say the investigating officer, this police officer, that police officer, even to an American police officer, if you make a complaint, it is inadmissible. Police officer is a police officer. And it does not also say that it should have been made at a particular point of time. Therefore, confession made at any point of time is hit by Section 25. Okay? Now, I also told you about Section 162. If a confession is made during the course of investigation, it also falls under Section 161. Therefore, bar under Section 162 will also be there. Okay. In the illustration, suppose the confession was made prior to the registration of the case, it will not fall under Section 161. Therefore, the bar under Section 162 is not applicable. Bar under Section 162 will come into play if the statement was recorded during the course of investigation under Section 161 CRPC. Now, therefore, this confession which was made prior to the registration of the case is hit by Section 25, not by 162. It cannot be used against him. What I said was it can be used in his favor because Section 25 bars the same being used against him. It can be used in his favor if he wants. Okay.
Sir, Kurmeswaran, Raga, his full name is not coming. In police case, the panchnama is built prior to the registration of case. Yeah. Therefore, what will be the panchnama? Whether that panchnama will be admissible?
Panchnama prepared before the investigation.
Yes.
What was the occasion for a police officer to prepare a panchnama before registration of the case? This is a matter to be done during the course of investigation. It may be a case where in the illustration, it may be a case where the police officer had some other information. Upon that information, he had gone to the spot. He prepared panchnama. Therefore, it is prepared during the course of investigation. It is admissible. But the FIR is not admissible because it is a statement under Section 161. Hit by Section 162. Because already investigation has commenced. Yes.
We have unmuted Priyanshu Yadav. I was just observing that he's just jotting down the notes. It shows that what interest he was having. But I will ask Priyanshu to just restrict to one question. Let the question
yes,
not
sir,
go to that level that it becomes the webinar itself.
Okay, sir. Sir, my question is, Section 24 is saying that if the accused person appears to him reasonable for supporting that by making it, he will gain any advantage or avoid any evil of temporal nature in reference to the proceeding against him. So my question is that if any MLA is saying to the accused person, go and confess, I will provide your poor girlfriend of 5 lakh rupees, then whether it will hit by Section 24 or not, whether it will amount to inducement or not.
Surely, brother. Surely it is an inducement. See, what is voluntary? Uninfluenced by anything. Uninfluenced by anything. So these three words used here are not exhaustive. The test is whether it is voluntary or not. The court has to test whether it is voluntary or not. The court need not confine itself. Yes.
But sir, in last para, it is written that that he believed that any kind of he can avoid any kind of evil or temporal nature with reference to the proceeding against him.
Yes.
So in many cases, I have seen that judge was Supreme Court was saying or High Court was saying that the inducement or threat or promise should come from the reference to the proceeding against him,
yes.
Not otherwise. Like outraging the caste will be not a threat to the accused person if the sarpanch is saying
I
will.
Brother, it is purely a question of fact. You cannot have a straitjacket formula. In one case, the court may say on appreciation, this can't be taken as a precedent. First of all, please understand that. You will agree with me. It is not a precedent. It is a decision taken on facts. It cannot be cited as a precedent. In a given case, in the background of the given set of facts, the court may say that this will not amount to promise and this will not amount to threat and this will not amount to inducement. The court may say, but in a different case, in a different set of facts, court may say that this is. So it all depends upon the facts and circumstances of each case. Therefore, the judgments about which you want to make reference are not precedents at all. They are not binding either horizontally or vertically of any court. They are all findings and facts. In criminal cases, where is the question of any precedent? There are some cases where a law is laid down, then that becomes a precedent. Like okay. I told you about some judgments, there's a Chandu's case and all that. There, if law is laid down or if a principle is enunciated, then to that extent, the judgment is a precedent. But when the case is decided on facts, where is the question of the judgment becoming precedent? It's not a precedent at all. It's not binding. This judgment can only guide the court, subordinate judiciary, or even the Supreme Court on horizontally. Okay, it can only guide. It is not a precedent. Therefore, it is a matter where decision is to be taken based on the facts. Okay, please.
Okay. Thank you.
We have unmuted Anupama Agarwal. The question will be asked directly. And I think we are touching seven. So we should take only one or two questions.
Yes, please.
Yes. Anupama is not unmuting herself. So I will read the question. If a statement is given under the special law.
Yes.
Under the special law, which states that the statement is readable as an evidence against him, how can he escape from such statements when such statements are made involuntarily?
No, but involuntarily. See, first of all,
Anupama has got unmuted directly. She will ask. Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Can I? Yes.
Sir, please, can I ask the question?
Please.
Yeah. See, under the Companies Act, in the Companies Act, under Section 217.
Anupama, could you come closer to the mic? There's too much echo.
Will answer.
Under Section 217, it is written that the statement is readable as an evidence against him.
Okay.
And such statements are actually involuntary.
Yes.
But now the case has been, the complaint case has been filed by the SFIO.
Okay.
So how can he, and the statements were given involuntarily.
Okay.
So how can he,
Please take the answer. See, first of all, under the Companies Act, there is no police officer investigating the case. It is a private complaint procedure instituted by an authority competent as specified in the Act itself, number one. Number two, he is not a police officer at all. And as per the judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court, he is not even deemed to be a police officer for the purpose of Section 25 of the Evidence Act. So far as Companies Act is concerned, I am sure he is not a police officer. Therefore, Section 25, Section 27 are not applicable. Section 24 and 30 are applicable. And whether the confession statement made to the officer was voluntary or not, it proceeds from the statement has been made to a person in authority. To that extent, there is admission. Now, whether it was out of fear, whether it was out of threat, whether it was out of any promise, etc., is a matter to be elicited by way of cross-examination. You have to bring on record circumstances to doubt the voluntariness. That is what you have to do. You cannot have a definite defense in your hands. During cross-examination, you have to establish, or you may have some other evidences also. You may put some defense witness. If it is true that he was attacked by this man, you can put some witness and he will say, and if you have sustained injuries, you can put a medical record. Like that only you would establish that. It's a question of fact.
So
you cannot have a straitjacket formula. Yes.
So the problem here is that under Section 2126, a person can be only given a bail if he can prove himself that the he is not a guilty of the contempt. The cross examination and all will happen later when the proceedings will go on. Because of Section 2126 under the Companies Act, he is not getting the bail. So cross examination issue will come later. So how will he defend himself to get a bail?
You challenge that provision. You challenge that provision as unreasonable. Violating Article 14,
constitutional validity of that provision is already challenged.
That is what I am saying.
That has not been held.
Now, so, I tell you, I want to inform you, you know very well, because you are practicing on the criminal side also. See, the similar provision is found in Section 37 of the Narcotics Act. That was challenged. The court has held it is constitutional. Then what can we do for that? We can't help. Now, because of Section 37, there's a similar provision. In Narcotics Act cases, in respect of commercial quantities, bail is not granted at all. As a rule, bail is not granted. So but that is the law, that is the view taken by the Honorable Supreme Court. What can we do? We are bound by that. Okay. Yes, next question, ma'am.
This is the last question, then we will just have a other wrap up for 5 minutes. We have unmuted Palvi. Palvi, the question, please.
Good evening, Your Lordship.
Yes, please.
Basically, there's something known as Memorandum and Seizure Panchanama. This relates to Section 27 of the Indian Evidence Act.
Yes.
Wherein, when a thing is stolen and the accused says that I have kept the stolen goods here. So basically, a statement is taken down by the police wherein they describe that this is what the accused said. That is known as a memorandum panchanama, and then later on the seizure panchanama is done where the police actually go to the place and they seize the objects. Now, generally when it is put up to him during the time of evidence, he denies it. So how can such a statement be proved against the accused? Does it amount to confession? Because Pullakodi Kottaya does say that part where he says that this is a knife with which I killed, that cannot be used. But in this case, how to establish the link then? Technically, how to take it into evidence, reading it into evidence during the recording of evidence?
No, please tell me, first of all, what was the hidden property? What is happened?
No, it is basically a stolen property, 379.
Very good. It's a stolen property. So, first of all,
stolen property.
Yes. First of all, in the statement, I have hidden the hidden, let us say, the gold ornament. I have hidden the gold ornaments in my house. This is admissible.
Yes.
The stolen golden ornament, the stolen is to be removed. Stolen,
yes.
He speaks of the history. So that is inadmissible. That is to be removed. That is Pullakodi Kottaya norms. So from out of the long statement, you have to remove, you have to minimize it, which is so much of the statement information which distinctly leads to a discovery. For the purpose of discovery, what amount of statement is required? So the property is there. I have hidden enough. What is that property? Gold jewels. That's all. And whether it was stolen, whether I have found the same elsewhere, or it was hidden by someone else. This part is not admissible. That's what Pullakodi Kottaya says. But it is to be proved, as I told you, this property, the stolen property, used to be established. Otherwise, statement itself is inadmissible. How to prove that? The owner of the goods will say, this property was my property, which I kept in my house, which was stolen. So the stolen property was found in the possession of the accused. It was recovered on the basis of the statement given. Now apply section 114 of the Evidence Act. The presumption is that he has stolen. So that is how the link is to be established.
Okay. Yes, sir, but when he actually denies making such a statement to the police itself or says it was under coercion, how can such a statement be?
In every case, accused will deny. In which case the accused will admit that, yes, I made the statement. Yes, discovery has made out of my statement. In which case he will accept. In every case he will deny. So because he denies, the court is not going to accept the denial. Okay.
Okay,
so if there are reasons to disbelieve, the court will disbelieve. If there are reasons to believe, the court will believe. Okay. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Sir, it's now 7:05 and we have touched on 2 hours. It had been a wonderful session. I can only say that the way you have assimilated the company law, criminal procedure, C4, NDPS, that shows the volume of the manner in which, rather, I would say one can always take a cue how to assimilate the entire facts, put it across, because it's not just while delivering a webinar, one has to assimilate the facts. But even in the law, we see that there are large number of facts, large issues, judgments, etc. But we are always, it's just like they say that you have a ticking bomb in your hand. So you have to control the ticking bomb and put the things also on the right way. So before we part, we will ask, what is your tip to the participants? Because we have a large number of people also watching on the Facebook as well as on this. That what is your key? How should one assimilate the facts? How should the entire facts be funneled so that they can be put across while drafting, then while preparing at the home? Because it's always that they say the best of the arguments are always invariably developed from one courtroom to the another, because that becomes a trigger point.
Thank you very much for this question. So I will tell as to what I was doing when I was practicing on the trial side. Because most of these issues are very relevant for the trial side lawyers, then for the appellate side lawyers also. Now I would request you, Two, first of all, read the charge sheet, the statement, the witness, the documents, not once, twice, thrice. Several times you read it. You just simply, whatever is asked by the judge or whatever is asked by the prosecutor, anybody else, you should say in which page this is stated, by whom it is stated. To that extent, you should make yourself very thorough with the facts of the case, number one. And take very detailed instructions from your client. And whenever you have any doubt about some particular fact involved in the case, so far a criminal case is concerned, call the client. Ask him as to what had happened at that time. So whether there was bus going in, he will give some information he will give. From out of that, you can develop. He may say that at a particular point of time, I was in Chennai or I was in Mumbai. So from that, you get a clue now. So you can further ask him what are the materials to show that you were there, et cetera, et cetera. Like that, you will get a lot of defenses from out of that. So this is the first thing. Secondly, before going to take up a case, what are all the laws involved, what are all the provisions involved? Read them not only once, twice, thrice, any number of times. And first of all, understand the law, know the first principle. Today I have not cited many judgments, I have not read any judgment for that matter. I spoke only on first principles. Read the provision, know the first principle, first of all. And after knowing the first principle, in order to ensure as to what is the position of law as on today, as the last resort, go to the judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court as well as your own High Court and the other High Courts, of course, and read them. Then make yourself thorough with the facts as well as law. Then you go to the court to do the case. This is what I would suggest to our friends. I am very happy that so many people are participating. It shows their interest in the learning, and I will be very happy if I have succeeded in triggering that thought process in this in the endeavor of yours. I am immensely thankful. I profusely thank you for providing me this platform. Thank you. Thank you.
No, no doubt at all. I would say that you're saying that even if at one point of mine, somebody has been triggered the point, I will say that it's not triggering the point. Rather, you have hit the bullseye. Many people would cherish that. The way it has been put across, because triggering sometimes doesn't break the desired result. But as we said last time, that we had large number of participants in the participation itself while they was watching. But another fact which I'm repeating again, that even on our YouTube channel, that is Beyond Law CLC, you have the maximum hits, maximum views. It only shows that the manner in which you have elucidated the issues becomes very, very clear. Amongst us, we have advocate Vikashi Sharma. He's been watching and participating in a lot of webinars. He's time and again, whenever he comes on your platform to hear you, I've seen that he's writing thank you. I said, besides my being saying thank you, it is just like Beyond Law CLC, I would like some person beyond me also saying thank you, so that it shows an expression that it's not a tutored one, that time and again I'm only saying beyond. Thank you.
Thank you. Before that, only one second. Yes, I tell you about the last and my answer to the last query. In one case, just I was referring, as a judge, I am saying, I was just referring to the records. I did not notice the action register, you know, the first entry made by the medical officer. Then I called for that. I found that the doctor had made a small entry like this, and he is under the severe mental depression and take extra care. This gave me insight. Then I called for, then I asked the accused, then called for record. Then I found there were 65 pages of documents showing that he was mentally ill. It was on that ground he was acquitted ultimately. That is why I said that a lawyer should not feel that any statement or any information is wasteful information. He should get every information. So thank you, Mr. Vikas. And one more thing, I'm really very proud that many lawyers, and as you mentioned, We are also participating. I'm very happy.
No, sir. Thank you to all the participants. I will just ask Vikas Shil Sharma to put in words. Before that, I say that tomorrow another session. Today we had the confessions, which is an integral part of proceeding etc. in the criminal law. Tomorrow we have a webinar at 5 p.m. Procedural law, master or servant. That issue keeps on hovering in the mind of a lawyer. And amongst us will be three honorable sitting judges, it shows that people are actually appreciating that we are putting things in the right perspective. Tomorrow we have Justice Rajiv Sahay in law, a judge from a sitting judge of Delhi High Court. Then we have Justice Vibhu Bhakru, judge Delhi High Court. And then Justice Dama Seshadri Naidu, judge Bombay High Court. So three different, three judges giving three different facets in a different way. I can say that it looks very interesting and knowledgeful. So all those participants who actually want to connect, they can connect us through Instagram or Facebook for the updates besides what we have told today. Over to Vikas, and thank you for all the participants, not only who have participated on Zoom, plus those who have watched us on the Facebook, plus those who will watch us subsequently, even on the YouTube channel when this entire webinar would be. Stay safe, stay blessed. Everyone remain happy. Vikas, just quick, Vikas Shil Sharma, just one word, two, three lines from yourself, because I said time and again, you post it on the chat box. You should be unmuted and express your views. Vikas? Vikas, you are there? Vikas Shil Sharma.
Sir, hello.
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you, please.
Is it audible?
Yes, yes.
Rather, Vikas, I will say you, you can show your video also.
Thanks. Thanks, my lordship, for a wonderful session. And thanks to, special thanks to Mr. Vikas and his team for a wonderful session.
Thank you, everyone. This is called short, crisp. There couldn't be anything more crispier than what Vikas will say. And I am feeling more proud because he's also Vikas. Thank you, everyone.